In the beginning, there was nothing. It was dark, pitch black. And then came the light. And with the light, we saw colors. And we loved what we saw. Isn't this beautiful? My name is Karl Johan Bertilsson, Swedish, as Configura is. And I've had the honor and the privilege to work with color in more than 20 years and in more than 80 countries on this planet. One of the most fascinating jobs on this planet, because color touches us all, in all aspects. And to your surprise, today, I will talk to you also about color. We will talk about color in design, and I will present you and introduce you to our vision of the color trends for interior design based on global forecasting. Whoops, let's go back. Oh my gosh. I love you guys laughing, isn't that fantastic? One of the first questions I ask everybody when I give a lecture, and that was before the next picture, is, do you like color? Do you love color? And I think I still haven't met one single person on this planet who said no. Everybody says, I love color. And my next question is, okay, do you think color in design is important? And everybody says, yes, it is. So why on earth, ladies and gentlemen, why on earth do we insist on using white? You know that on this planet, more than 80% of the paint being sold for houses is white. So why, if color is so important, do we, people even say, oh, this is so trendy. Nah, this is not trendy. This has been like this forever, or 80% of the world, right? Most of the cases that we know is that people do not make color decisions because we're afraid to make color decisions. If I paint the wall white, nobody will say anything. We'll say, oh, it's white. But if I make a color decision and I paint that wall red, blue, green, or even beige, they will ask me, why did you paint that wall in that color? And I have to defend myself. And if I don't know color, I will have a problem defending myself. It's one of the reasons. I also find, unfortunately, a lot of architects on this planning saying, you know, default is always white because making color decisions take too long time. Everybody will have an opinion and we don't know how to communicate about color. So it's white. But did you know that white and our preference for white, or actually focusing on white or being the perfect expression of our aesthetics, is based on a historic misunderstanding? Do you know this story? You're partially guilty for this. I will come back to that. But it turns out that in the year 1506, there is this master of art, Michelangelo, that everybody talks about. He was present in Rome when they found a group of statues under the palace of the Roman Emperor Nero. They found what they call the Lacoon group, a beautiful group of statues, white from the antique. Michelangelo and his artists said that if this group from the antique was white, that means, and they said that, you know, the Roman Empire is the perfect expression for aesthetics, then the perfect expression for aesthetics should be white. It was like equal. So everything they did, saying that we want to be like the antique and we will make it white. So during the Renaissance, the Baroque, Bernini, and a lot of other artists, they made these sculptures and statues in white, representing the antique. So for hundreds of years, we were all coached that the perfect expression, or aesthetical expression, should be white. In 1776, you had a guy on this continent called George Washington, who liked to portray himself like a Roman emperor, and he built a city completely white based on the same fact. Picasso said, okay, if we want to make the capital of democracy, and democracy for George Washington, according to what I understand, is that it should be white, because they had, you know, the Senate and everything comes from the Roman Empire. That we make Washington white, like it used to be in Rome. Okay, so fine. So let's build Washington, D.C., and make it white. In the year 1882, a group of archaeologists found below the Temple of Pantheon in Athens in Greece, for the first time, a cave where they found statues from the antique, from the Greek antique. As these statues had been in darkness for thousands of years, they have kept the colors. And for the first time, they discovered that the colors of the antique, they were not white. They used extreme colors. These statues are called the Peploscore. And that was the first time that they actually realized that they had lived in a mistake. For now, almost 400 years, they have lived in a complete mistake, that white was the perfect expression of the Roman or the Greek antique. That was confusing. So what happens? And now why are you laughing? You were not supposed to laugh. This is serious stuff, guys. But isn't it true? When you look at the white Apollo here, it feels correct. When you look at the painted Apollo, which it should be, because that's what he looked like, it doesn't look right. I mean, you can see everything, right? On the white thing, you cannot see anything. So still today, we still have this in our nerve system that it should be white when it shouldn't. So this is one of the reasons why white is so dominant in our aesthetics today. And I'm here to talk to you about color. And I will make my only political statement today. Because now I have expressed, for 20 years I've traveled the world talking about how important it is to work with color in design. When at the same time there is a huge movement growing in the world today with a group of people, usually angry young men, that hate color so much they're prepared to kill for it. That's my political statement. But this is part of the problem. Scandinavian design, Google Scandinavian design. I come from Stockholm. Configura is Linköping in Sweden. You know, Scandinavian design looks like this according to Google. So we equally guilty of this. But this is not Scandinavian design. Today, yes. People use a lot of white in Scandinavian design because we do have a lot of darkness. We need this light and everything. But when you go to Swedish home, it doesn't look like this, to be honest. Historically, and not only in Sweden, when people had money, they used color. This is one of the most famous artists, Karl Larsson, from the Sweden, representing how a Swedish home actually looked like. So if he would make Scandinavian design, should be more like this, right? Joseph Frank, and I will come back to him, he was an Austrian architect, is one of the most influential architects and designer of Scandinavian interior design. He escaped the Second World War, moved to Sweden, and some of his fantastic colors still is some of the most important patterns in Swedish homes or in Scandinavian homes. I will come back to him because it's quite fascinating. But here's the thing. We have been coached for hundreds of years that white is a perfect expression of aesthetics. And I will be very honest, I like white too. White can be beautiful. And that when you use a lot of white, it's a lot easier to enhance other beautiful colors, for sure, right? So there's nothing wrong with white as long as it is a conscious decision that we want to have white and nothing else, right? I will give another example. We had this project with this company, Haier, which is the largest producer of white goods in the world, Chinese company, when they said, look, we have a huge problem. We cannot sell washing machines, air conditioning in Europe. Why? Can you tell us why? And one of the reasons we saw was because they were selling the wrong white. A European consumer would never buy the white that is being sold in China. It was too yellowish. So after research and after spending time understanding and understanding all of the different white nuances, because remember, white is the most difficult colors because the slightest change in white, you will immediately tell a difference. So we spent a lot of time investigating and trying to find. So from a yellowish white, they now launched a bluish white on the European market, which immediately gave results, right? So my question is, how important is color? I told you about Haier. I like to talk about Google. Have you heard about this? Did you know that, you know, when you click on the links in Google or Gmail, these are blue links. That's when they make the money. Ka-ching! 10 cents, right? Ka-ching! Right? Some years ago, these blue links were slightly greenish-blue. Slightly greenish-blue. And with time, they began manipulating this blue color, still blue, until what they are today, which is a reddish blue. And they have now documented, in its official documents, that just by manipulating this blue link, they have increased their revenue by $200 million per year. Because we prefer to click on reddish blue than on greenish blue links. We talk about blue, and I will come back to this time after time. You can never go and say, oh, I think blue is good. Because there's so many different blues, and one blue can be completely wrong, and the other blue can be completely right. So we have to make our job to choose exactly what nuance we want to have, right? According to research, when from a purchase, a consumer behavior, when we make a purchase, up to 92% of a decision whether you will buy something or not, that can be a bottle of shampoo, a computer, a car, is a visual assessment. If you like what you see, you buy it. It didn't used to be like that. When you bought a car, you kicked the tires and said, oh, that's a good car, right? Now, when you buy a car, you open the door, you sit down, and you say, this is beautiful. I feel like home, right? That's a feeling. It's a visual assessment. Now, here comes the thing. About 90% of that visual assessment depends on color only. Only. That means if you buy a Ferrari, you go to the Ferrari, and if you don't like the color of that car, you will not buy it. And it doesn't matter if it's a Ferrari. It doesn't matter how good it is. If you don't like the color, you don't buy it. This is how important color is. This gives you a huge responsibility as designers to integrate color in your design from the very beginning, not at the end and say, okay, what color should we use? But in the beginning should be a conscious decision. And this is what we always talk about. Color is beautiful. It's passion. You know, it's something that you get the feelings from. And that it should be like that. The second step, however, should be a rational decision. Is my feeling correct? And how can I confirm my feeling to make a rational decision? Right? And this is one of the reasons why, if you look historically, there has been so much research to try to understand how to describe color. Aristoteles, the big philosopher, was the first one who talked about this. We have Leonardo da Vinci, and we're talking about thousands of years of research. In the 1920s, a group of Swedish architects sat down and said, look, there's been people trying to do this for 1,000 years, and still we don't have a conclusion. What should we do? And that's when they began working on trying to conclude how we can describe color, right? So I will give you now, this is the part where you have to really pay attention. The rest of the speech you can fall asleep, whatever you want, okay? It's up to you guys. But now I want you to pay attention because I want you to learn something because it will make your life so much easier. I will go through very quickly. I have this 7-minute rule, cannot take more than 7 minutes, to learn how to describe colors visually. And then I will make a test. If you don't pass this test, number one, you cannot leave the room. If I'm in a good mood, I will give you a little gift to the person who answers the question correctly. Are you on? Great. So the challenge of today is that I have two color combinations. Color combination one, color combination two. These are extremely famous color combinations. All of you know what they are. And I want you to tell me what they are. Okay, not right now. After I've gone through the system. And as I'm Swedish and very square-minded and structured, you know how we are, all of this. We would do it very simple. So I go through the system, I ask you the question, and if you think you know the answer, raise your hand. If you answer correctly, I will hand over this beautiful little measurement device for color. Okay? Done? Are you ready? When they began the research, one of the first questions they asked is, what is color? And when you go to school, unfortunately, there is not much color education in school, but when we go to school, many of the people, or many of us learn that color is really how you produce color, how lights are mixed, or how you mix pigments and everything, which is fine. But for me as a designer, I don't care how you produce color. It's completely irrelevant for me. That's the producer's problem. The only thing that matters for me is what I see. That's the only thing. When I choose a color because I like what I see. And I want to see that same color in the environment I'm designing. So, what we need to have is a system based on visual perception, on nothing else but that, right? Leonardo da Vinci, this very famous master of art, he was the first person actually mentioned to be able to describe all of these millions of colors that we can see. We need to use six reference points. Today we know this as the opponent color theory. Okay? According to research today, we also know. I have to turn down the volume. Gangnam Style. There you go. According to research today, we know that we are born, when babies are born, we are already programmed with these six colors. We understand these six colors. And this is one of the reasons why you have in toys to use blue, green, red, yellow. Because a baby can understand these colors. If you use orange, purple, they're more confusing. Okay? We can go through this forever, but I would leave it like this. So with the help of these six, what we call elementary colors, we make a three-dimensional color space. In this color space, there is a position for all of these 10 million colors you can see. Is that okay? Everybody understand so far? Okay. So here's the thing. To be able to describe that exact position in the color space, we have to describe two main parts. One part is where you are in the color circle, which means the hue of the color, reference to yellow, red, blue, and green. Is that okay? So what you see at the second part, actually, which is called R90B, what does that mean? That means a red color that is actually 90% blue, right? So check this, just for you to understand. You go from yellow to red to blue to green to yellow. So R90B, we can also say that it's a B with 10% red. It's the same thing, but we'll always go clockwise. So R90B is a red color, 90% blue, or a blue color with a little red inside. Is that okay? So once we have that color family, we also have to describe how dark the color is and how strong the color is. What we call scientifically the chromaticness and the blackness of the color, which is this part. 10 describes the percentage of blackness. 0 is white, 100 is black. So 10% means that it's not a very dark color, right? It's quite light. 50 describes how strong the color is, where 0 is gray, neutral. And 50 is somewhere in between 0 and 100, which means that it's strong, but it's not very strong. In other words, it's a blue color, a little reddish. It's not dark at all. And it's half strong color in this color family. Yeah? Are you ready for the competition now? That's my 7 minutes, okay? Good. So, I will explain to you what I will give to you if you answer the question. The thing is this, you guys, and we are here and you are here because you work on the computer, digitally. And one of the most important things when you work digitally to understand, and I know all of you understand this, is that the color you see on the screen is never correct. Never, ever. It doesn't matter what you do. Okay, my screen is different from your screen, it will never be correct. So what we see, the more digitally the designer works with color, the more important it is to be able to describe what the actual color should be. Okay, whether it's with NCS or with anything else, but it's becoming more and more important. So in this digital world, we have this little color measurement. Oh, I brought this picture up because this comes from you guys here. You know, so I have this on the screen, and I say, oh, this is beautiful, and I show it on another screen, and I say, oh, it's ugly, it looks terrible, because it looks completely different, right? Specify the color, describe the color, and we are good. So, this is a little color reader. You will have a trend card in here. You will have a little color reader, so you can read colors. Specify, you have an app in the, on the phone. I will have two of these to give away today. So I have two color combinations that I want you to tell me. So raise your hand when you know the answer. If you're right, I'll be more than happy to give you one of these. Okay, are you ready? No? I will not help you a bit. Huh. No, just raise your hand if you know the answer. Raise your hand over there.
Okay, so 10% blackness.
Don't tell me that. I want you to tell me what it is. This is one of the most famous color combinations in the world. The combination of these two colors makes something that is extremely famous on this planet. Right there. Well, you're first. She thinks it's the Swedish flag. How many agree that it's a Swedish flag? Raise your hand. I will give you this is not the Swedish flag. I will give you a second opportunity. No, I'm kidding. You are very good. That means that you have understood. And I will give you this little device, and I will tell you why. This is not the Swedish flag. This is one of our oldest and biggest clients. We're actually responsible for the corporate identity of IKEA. The founder, as you know, passed away recently. Mr. Ingvar Kamprad. Everything they're doing at IKEA based on NCS or the NCS system and everything. But as I knew, because I'm very clever, that you would say that, I actually showed also the Swedish flag. And the reason is, and I tell you why, because, you know, IKEA is one of the best ambassadors of my country in the world. And they want to look Swedish, like you thought they looked, right? But if you look at the description, they're slightly different, but they're so clever, they cannot use the Swedish colors because that's protected. That's national, you know, national treasury or treasure. You cannot use that. So just by twisting the color slightly in some sides, you can register as a corporate identity and still project it as they were Swedish. So anyway, an applause to the Swedish flag because I think that's good enough. Congratulations. And here's the last one, okay? So I guess now it's a big audience, so raise your hand and yell at the same time. If not, it's gonna be terrible because I saw that some of you raised 10 at the same time. So just yell and, you know, the one who yells the little, yeah, three. Here, yeah, go. Somebody yelled very loud. How many people believe this is the US flag? And who answered the US flag? Can you stand up? Great, good job. An applause for Mr. American or the American flag. Great, good job, good job. But it's not correct. I got you there, huh? No, I'm being bad. It's not the American, it's the French flag. It's so funny, but I thought you would say that. So I just wanted to be a little bit bad to you guys. There is a fundamental difference, though, between the French flag and American flag, but I think you answered that correctly, so that's good enough. There you go. Anyway, now, because this is the thing. When you work with color, to be able to even to make color decisions, you should be able to understand what you see. And if we should be able to discuss a color, this is the first thing. We need to be able to speak the same language, right? So the French flag and the American flag are different. The red and the blue should not be the same because they are different. And we have to respect that. And if we talk about branding and other things, that's very, very important. Because I only have 1 hour today, and you will wave your hand when I don't have enough time to talk, and I will try not to talk too much. Let me give you an anecdote. When I came into America yesterday to Chicago, I went to the passport control, and the guy asked me, "What are you doing here? What are you supposed to do here?" "I'm giving a lecture." "Oh, about what? About color?" "You mean red, blue, green, and stuff like that?" And I said, "Yeah." "Can you give lectures about that?" And I said, "Yeah, if you want, please join me." And he laughed and everything. But the thing is, yeah, because there's so much to talk about when it comes to color. This is one of the most important things when it comes to color design, to create color harmonies, right? You know this. And you know this exercise, right? You know when you stare at this. So stare at this for 10 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And boom, what do you see? Bridge flag. Why is this? This is called after image. This theory is where we get to what we call the complementary colors from, right? Because as they complement each other, this is one of the easiest way to choose color harmonies. But the tricky thing is that we cannot say like red and blue, right? Because we have to specify exactly where in the color space they are. So this is the thing why we still need to go to these color systems, to understand where is the center point, to understand the perfect complementary color, like in this case. And in the NCS color circle, you see that the point is actually not the center, because the complementary is a little bit different from the other part. Okay? Anyway, Joseph Frank, talking about color harmonies, he produces this kind of patterns, beautiful patterns. You will see in Swedish homes, cost a fortune to buy these textiles or curtains and furniture, right? And he uses very, very strong colors that make beautiful design. Now, why is it this beautiful? And this is a long, long time ago, long before NCS and everything. When you look and you analyze his patterns, you can actually see one of the things that is the basics for color harmonies. They have something in common. As you can see, these three colors on the top are all 20% black and 60% chromatic. Per definition, as these are visual descriptions, they will always look good together when they have a similar visual description. So understanding this, we can work with color harmonies from a rational perspective much easier, not only intuitive, right? So we can have colors with the same hue, with the same nuance, the same chromaticness, the same blackness, same whiteness, and it goes on. That's where we have a color academy, so, you know. Anyway, so when we do color consultancy, obviously we always take all of these things into consideration, the intuitive, the feeling, and the rational part, which is very important to confirm all the time that what we're doing is correct, right? So, now I want to introduce you to my favorite part, a little more about color psychology. And I will drink some water. Because now it's time that we will talk about this. One of my favorite topics. Like I told you, I have talked or I worked with color for more than 20 years. And if you had asked me 10 years ago what I thought about color trends, to be honest, I would have told you that, you know, interesting, inspirational, is it functional? I don't know. This is more than 12 years ago, I was in Buenos Aires in Argentina to, for the first time, work with color trends. And that was the first time I understood how important it is to understand the trends of the future. At the end of the day, it's about market psychology. We have to choose colors we know people will prefer in the coming years. And to be able to understand that, we have to make rational decisions. And one of the first things that we do that is so important is, first of all, to understand what is trendy today. Because if we understand color trends today, it is quite easy to understand how our brains and our color preferences will move, in what direction. There is research showing, and I'm simplifying the life very, very much right now, but research shows that it's actually a repetitive cycle. Okay? So if we are bombarded with a lot of strong colors at a given time, our brains get tired, and we want to go to the other extreme, the neutral extreme. And to go through to the other extreme, there are certain steps that we have to go through to clean our brain and get our brain ready for certain color trend areas. Okay? So this is something that we follow very closely every time. This is, like I said, simplifying things very much. It's also an overlapping. The different steps overlap. It's not because I say 1st of January, it's suddenly woof, everything changes and we have different trends, right? Because it's not true. That's just a commercial thingy. So when I will present to you, my story today will go through years, not one specific year. We will focus on one, the 2019, but I will talk to you a little bit about what happens before and what probably comes after, okay? Let me give you an example. You know this TV series? Orange is the New Black, kind of conquered the world completely. And you know the story that they said was in the newspapers everywhere now? They had to change the colors of the uniforms in the prison because people were beginning to use orange, so if they escaped from prison, they wouldn't know if they were prisoners or normal people. You heard that? So he said, thanks to this TV series, orange was pushed a lot to the market. It made orange trendy. And it's a truth with a modification, but which is very important. This could never have happened if our brains were not ready to receive chromatic strong colors at this moment. It wouldn't have happened. But as we were at that moment in a time where we wanted to have more chromatic colors, this pushed us. This is one of the drivers who pushed our preferences to orange. Okay, so we always work with two areas. We work with the natural movements of colors, the natural way colors move in directions. And we work with the drivers that will push certain regions or certain areas or certain colors more than others, which is the most tricky part, to understand which are the things that happens on our planet that will actually change our minds to prefer certain color areas, right? So I will present to you the global mega drivers of today. And this is important. I will not talk about the American drivers, European drivers, Chinese drivers. We will talk about drivers that we see influence most of the people of this planet at the same time. This is tricky, but there are some things that we know do this, okay? Let me introduce you first of all to these guys. And this is important because these guys are now growing up. And in the coming years, they will be the ones who will be most exposed to trends and most willing to buy trendy things. Because the Generation Z in a couple of years will be in the 20s. They will begin making money and begin consuming. Do you know Generation Z? Have you heard who they are? And what is the difference between the millennials and the Generation Z? Let me pinpoint just some important things, okay? This is the first generation, and this is very important. This is the first generation actually were born with a smartphone. And we know today that this has affected not only our psychology, but even the way we function as human beings, our metabolism. They talk about the goldfish mentality. You heard about that? Goldfish can concentrate for about 8 seconds. After 8 seconds, if you don't give them a stimulus, they will try to find something else, right? Generation Z is the same. You have to give them stimulus constantly. The good thing about Generation Z is they can do a lot of things at the same time. They have 5 different chat forums chatting with 20 different people at the same time, and they can handle that. That's a new thing, right? But it's a generation that has dramatically different from the previous generation, the millennials, right? What we see of the generation C, which is also very important, these are doers. The millennials were more passive, observing, looks nice, but let other people deal with it, okay? The generation C are the doers. Because we will talk more about what is happening now is that we are entering an era when more and more people want to be actively change the world. This is being pushed by Generation Z. This generation also grew up in a world which was different, in turmoil, terrorism, ISIS, you know, all of these weird things that are happening on this planet. And when these things happen, there's an increased need of faith, spirituality, or believing in something, holding on to something. And that's also a very important driver, okay? The climate is changing. Now, what that depends on, I will not discuss, but the climate is changing, okay? 2016 was the hottest year ever on this planet, 2017 the second hottest year, 2018 will be the fourth hottest. In my country, will be the hottest year ever in history. We never had so many forest fires ever, and I live close to the North Pole. It's quite dramatic. Anyway, and it doesn't matter, because we're being bombarded now with the news of what's happening on our planet with the climate. And this is affecting our way of thinking and behaving, okay? The other thing is the urbanism. Something that people have been talking about for a long, long, long time. You know, they had a perfect scheme that, you know, this year or this decade it will be like this and this and this and this. And suddenly China began building multi-million, you know, people cities. India. And they say, okay, that's the Chinese. That's, you know, let them do whatever, you know. But this is now a phenomenon that we see in all the world. What they talk about is an extreme super-duper urbanization, faster and bigger than anybody expected. People are moving into the cities, and this has consequences. When you move into the cities, you don't live in the same size of area, you live in smaller spaces, closer together. So there's a lot of things we have to take into consideration, right? We're taking the nature into our homes again when we live in the urban areas, okay? There's even terminologies, you know all of this, urban farming, vertical farming, guerrilla farming, that's my favorite. You know guerrilla farming? Heard about that? It's when you live in a city and you see an abandoned lot or and you say, oh, nobody lives there, so let's go and put some carrots and stuff there, okay? Until somebody comes and says, no, you cannot, okay. Then they try to find somewhere else. That's guerrilla farming, it's cool, huh? I think in New York, they're building now the first underground park, right? So there's a lot of things happening. It's a little bit, you know, based on a thing, what we call an apocalyptic story, because we believe that something is happening to the world, and we have to make sure that even though we live in the cities, we have to be able to survive and not depending on the countryside. So we bring in all of the things into the cities to assure our living, right? We have talked for years when it comes to trends that when we live in this social world with internet, the social medias, there is so important to be able to close your eyes, dream away, and be somewhere else on this planet, to create a fantasy. But there is a big shift now that we're seeing. We're talking about something completely different, and much to do with also Generation Z. We talk about the times of awakening. People more and more do not want to close their eyes and dream, but rather live in what we are today and try to change our reality. Right? When we want to change the reality, a lot of people get scared, which takes us to the thing that we need strong leadership. We need to cling on to people who are strong. My country, which is considered to be one of the most democratic countries, according to most research, it's Switzerland, Sweden, and all these countries in the world. According to recent research, a fourth of the Swedes believe that it's more important with a strong leader than a democracy. And that's a growing thing in the world, right? And this is not a political statement. And Donald Trump is not the only guy who makes a difference, and because strong leadership is becoming more and more important. So we cling on to these guys who want to take the lead. But here's the thing. And this is a very, very important movement on this planet, okay? Last year, the first movie with a woman being the only superhero was launched to the market in the first time in the history. As a consequence of a long time of something that we have talked about that we call the new feminism. Years ago, three years ago, we first launched the idea of the new feminism, where you have corporate leaders actually saying that the women are taking over the world. Thank God. Sorry about that, yeah. But there is something positive about this. But it's happening. And it's happening. And the last year when we were discussing the trends, I said, should we repeat this story again? And what happened? First of all, the Me Too movement came out, which pushes this even further, changing the minds of the human being of reacting, thinking. Second thing, I had the privilege a year ago in August to have a workshop, a trend workshop with women from Saudi Arabia for the first time, something that was completely impossible years ago. I had two full days working with them, architects from Saudi Arabia women, and just all of my prejudices just were crushed. These women are some of the strongest people I've ever met, ambitious. And they told me in August last year, they said, just wait a couple of months and you will see. My country will also change. And we're talking one of the harshest governments or cities or countries in the world when it comes to women's rights. And 2 months later, they got the right to drive cars. Yeah, right? And then they got the right to go to football games. Yeah. Small steps, but enormously important for the people living in this region. And we see this is just a beginning of a movement in the world of women and the influence of the female world, okay? Smart homes, I will not talk much about this, but all the indications say that we are now living in an era when the smart homes are booming. For the first time, people can afford to invest in smart homes, okay? Next year, in 2019, the first Hyperloop will be built, inaugurated, reducing the travel time from Abu Dhabi to Dubai from 2 hours to 12 minutes. The Chinese are now building trains that go three times faster than this. Three times faster, two times faster than an airplane. This used to be a fantasy. This is reality now. This is talking about connecting people, connecting communities in a completely different way. So let me take you back a little bit, what we've talked about the stories, for you to understand in 2019. For 2018, we launched a story called High Tech Flower Power, based on the idea of urban living, bringing the nature into our homes, but based on smart technology. We don't have to be farmers. We can depend on smart technology and still grow our food in our homes, right? We had some beautiful constellations of greenish, purplish, and earth colors that represent the smoke midtones, right? And when seeing your work that I got here from Tracy, you see that, you know, there's a lot of the work you can see that you are bringing the nature into the homes. We talked about the luxurious minimalism. And once again, moving into the urban areas, living in small areas, the focus is that we should be minimalistic. But when you come to a home with a small surface, you still want to feel or see that the people have money, or you want to show people that you have money. So you invest in small details that makes it look luxurious. That's what we call luxurious minimalism, okay? So we projected very neutral colors, slightly purplish, with a very, very Scandinavian influence, which is the blue color, and we see this more and more, and the yellow, orangey, dark orange color representing more the brass, copper, gold metals, so the details we need to have in our interiors. And obviously, we find that in a lot of designs today, with the gold details, with the blues, right? Which is very, very more and more important in our interiors. We launched Urban Pride. You know, from our rough suburban areas taking over the awareness and be proud of where we live. But it's a very bombastic, it's a superhero. Yes, we're changing the world in a positive way, but it's superhero, right? So we have the mandatory blue and red superhero colors with the bombastic fire, colors of fire, smoke and everything, okay? I found this that Tracy sent me, which represents the idea. I do miss the bombastic colors in here, which would lift the design even more. Some details should be poof. And we talked about the New Africa. And this is a movement that is growing in importance more and more. The African designers more and more now are stepping out on their usual saying that, oh, you know, I do like the designers in Europe and America. No, today is African design, and they're proud of being African. And it's something that we already see in interior design with patterns and colors, all presenting the new, successful Africa. So now we come to 2019. And when we began with this, we said, it feels like 2019 is like a middle year, 2020, 2018, 19, what can happen in 19? And the more we began working with 2019, the more it became apparent that this is could be one of the most decisive years in the coming future. So we call this the birth of a new world. Based on that we need to keep a mind balance. When we want to change the world, we have to be well here. Based on cleaning the world, because we cannot live on this polluted planet anymore. It's just not possible. And we will change the world together, not like an individual, but together, right? And inviting technology as a partner, not as an enemy. Four main elements for what we see for the 2009 plus trends. Let's look at story number one. And I will introduce you to possibly one of the most important things, not possibly. I will introduce you to one of the most important things that exists for our survival, which is this.
Oh, it's so good. Oh, man.
It's a celebration for our waters. It's a celebration of our waters, and it's a contrast to this material, plastic. And you know this story. One of the best long-lasting materials that had ever been invented. A plastic bottle lasts for about 450 years. Ah, yeah. But there's a movement now, and you know, that more and more people say that plastic is one of the largest design failures on this planet. Why is that? Because the human being is not a very clever person sometimes, right? We throw more than 8 million tons of plastic in our oceans every year, accumulating year after year. And soon there will be more plastic than water in our fish in our oceans. When I gave this lecture for the first time in China, it was in Guangzhou, they came to me and said, you know, China, we don't like the ocean anyway. We don't have to swim, and who cares about the beaches and everything? I said, you know, okay, fine. But this is not the essence of this story, because there's a part that is even more dramatic about this. And this is this. What have been discovered is not that the plastic bottle is a problem, but it's the microplastic, the microfibers of the plastic that are being now poured into our waters, that are now coming into our drinking water, changing our metabolism. And this is a problem we live with today, and it's increasing, which means we need to do something today. We need to react, and we are reacting. So you know in design, we are now collecting the plastics, recycling the plastic. We have created even a new material called a new marble that is being introduced to our homes for new materials, which is fantastic. Stella McCartney, you know all of these famous designers, Nike has done all of these things, right? Trend story number one is called water, which is celebration to the water and to the design that we are recycling the plastics of our water, respecting and celebrating the color areas that we know will be very trendy, okay? And when I look at, I don't know if I clicked the button, but you can see there are very mid-tones, there are water colors, together with the very important, you know, faded, lid of a Coca-Cola bottle thingy kind of thing, right? Together with some beautiful pastelish colors faded from the ocean. If you look at the distribution in the color circle or in the color space, you can see that they're mid-tones. You can see that they make a beautiful complementary to each other, and they have a lot of similarities, which makes the composition of these colors a beautiful composition for your interiors. And we can see this. I mean, I don't think the designers of these have seen this, but we can see these colors already pop up in the designs that have been used by the CET design software, which is quite interesting. Right? Two. This is not me, as you can see, right? I do a lot of exercise, but not this kind of exercise. This is what everybody's been focusing on for so long. You have to be fit physically. Coming into an era wanting to change the world, our physical fitness is, of course, important, but it's even more important, our mental fitness. And I know in America, this is already a movement that corporates or corporations are now implementing a mandatory yoga sessions, wellness, you know, mental wellness sessions to get your mind going in the correct way. And this is becoming more and more and more important. Mental wellness is extremely important. And it has to do with spirituality, not so much about religion, because Generation Z does not talk about religion so much. But they talk about that we need to believe in something. Whatever it is, it's a spiritual thing. Cosmology, right? So the second story we call faith. And it's lifting what I talked about, the orange that has been around for some time, we see will be reinforced further in the coming years. So we have a beautiful constellations of oranges, a dark orange, because colors are getting darker and less chromatic. The blues, the neutrals, and a pinkish, which is actually also on the yellow-reddish side, as you can see here, which also makes a beautiful harmonic, even though they're very chromatic. And this is the only palette that remains, basically, where you still have very chromatic colors, because colors are fading. They're becoming paler and darker. Story number three. And this is the story about from being individualist like the millennials, you know, me, all of this is a we. We will not do anything by ourselves. We will do things together. Moving into the cities, we move into smaller areas, but maybe we have a common kitchen or a common living area, a barbecue area. We are creating living surfaces or living surroundings that are becoming more and more common. So we call this me into we evolution, and the story is called neighbor. Connecting people, changing the world together. One of these colors here is one of the most interesting colors, which is the green color in this constellation. That is a color individual that we see will gain a lot more power in the coming years. And it's being pushed, let me show you this. You know Bang & Olufsen, this Danish company? You buy one of these equipments, cost $10,000 or more. It's extremely expensive. When you invest this kind of money usually, you know, if it's a stereo or a hi-fi equipment, traditionally silver is black, nothing else. They're now launching this in this green color because they see that this green color now is becoming extremely important, pushing this green color in the future. Because if you buy this, I mean, if you buy a thing like this for $10,000, you will not change it tomorrow. You will keep it for some years, right? And you need to like it. So that's story number three, right? And let's look at the last trend, 2019. And this is the conclusive trend. This is the trend where we kind of put everything together now for the new world, okay? It's the birth of a new female world. Positive, very positive, kind, caring, right? And it reaches out and it celebrates a lot. The women that we're seeing are growing in importance, specifically for the Middle East traditions. And their colors of spirituality, which is very purplish. It is also rebirth of a world that we in Europe are saying bye-bye. So this is from a pure European perspective. Because right now, you know, with the Brexit, England even leaving the European Union, we live, it's a huge question mark. Nobody knows what will happen. And everybody's like walking around, we are afraid to do things in Europe right now because we don't know what will happen when England leaves the European Union. 2019, it's done. So whether it's good or bad, that's not the case, but we will know what will happen, and we can begin rebuilding the world again, from a European perspective, of course, right? We call this trend story Shine. The newer, like the bird phoenix raising from the ashes, creating the most beautiful world again. With some beautiful constellations of purple colors, together with this almost Tiffany blue color, you know, projected, because you know purple is one of the most powerful colors that exist. Expensive color, powerful, always connected to success and power and to spirituality. Position here in the color space, right? And I will give you a sneak peek, not on the colors, but the stories, because we are now working on the 2020 plus trends, just to give you an idea how this will be followed up and how things are connecting now and evolving for the future. So I will just show you very quickly 2020 plus trends we're talking about. Shades of incognito, new masculinity, human identity, evolving eclecticism is the stories we will present for the 2020 color trends that I hope we will be able to present to you someday also. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a pleasure to be with you here today. I always say that to me, color and music is basically the same thing. It is feeling, it is passion, it is beauty. So I always end my lectures with an inspirational tune with music and some beautiful color pictures from this planet. Hopefully giving you some inspiration and the guts to make color decisions in the future, because color makes a difference and it can make a huge difference. And many times the difference being a complete success and a complete failure of a product that you design. So with this, I will leave you and say thank you very much.